Hello and welcome to another edition of Word in the Burg, our monthly topical talk show about all things having to do with Harrisburg and the region. Thanks for joining us. Today, our guests are the great triumvirate of public works. We are joined by our public works director, Aaron Johnson, our deputy director, David West, and our city engineer, Wayne Martin. There's a lot of exciting projects underway, being spearheaded by this trio, and I thought we could use this opportunity to talk about things and how they're going to affect residents. So, Aaron, I'd like to begin with you, and let's start with street sweeping. There's been some notice in the news that changes are happening with street sweeping in the city. What's going on, and what should residents be on the lookout for?
Okay, sir. Thank you for having me this evening. First of all, I'd like to tell the public, Capital Regional Water, they decided to basically take over the street sweeping, okay? The city of Harrisburg no longer does street sweeping, effective January 1st, 2017. So what that means to the public is that you would not see a street sweeper until early spring, okay? So what the residents really need to understand is that our signs are still posted and that the city of Harrisburg is still responsible for the streets as far as the parking enforcement. The reason why it's very important to follow the street signs is because now we are in the season, the winter season, so we have inclement weather. So those signs represent a couple of things. For example, snow removal, okay, if our tree crew wants to work on trees, okay, well, we would actually schedule tree work in an area that we know we have street sweeping, okay? So also, if we want to repair the streets, that would be another reason why you need to follow the signs. So if it's just as simple as that. If you follow the signs, okay, you will have no issues because our parking enforcement will issue a ticket. So I have a volume of calls I've been receiving about this issue, you know. So again, I can't emphasize enough about just follow those street signs. But if you have any questions, you know, you can contact me at 717-315-2101. I'd be more than glad to help you and talk you through it, okay? But you will not see a street sweeper, and a lot of people are looking for the street sweeper. And the one thing that you gotta keep in mind in the wintertime is that anything below 32 degrees, the street sweeper is not effective anyway because most of the residue or the debris will be frozen to the ground, you know, so you won't see a sweeper. So again, pay attention to the signs and you'll be fine.
Okay, excellent. So not only is Capital Region Water taking over the street sweeping, but the current signs are in effect. People won't see any street sweepers until the spring. But we're still encouraging them to put their woody waste and their yard waste and their Christmas trees, for instance, still this month, out on along the street sweeping route. So another thing that we're doing is we're picking up those materials. Eventually, those materials are going to our new composting center. Would you like to give people a bit of an update on that and where this new location is going to be and what they could expect to eventually be able to bring there?
Okay, first of all, we still are picking up Christmas trees currently to January 31st, and you're supposed to put them out front at the curb, okay? And if we don't get them right away, trust and believe me, we will get them. But if you don't feel comfortable, we're not going to get them. Give me a call. But we're definitely going to pick them up. As far as the woody waste, the same thing. You want to put it out during the street sweeping, follow the signs, and put it out to the curb, and we pick it up. And with the leaves falling late this year, sir, we still are picking up leaves as the weather permits. You know, so if you have leaves in bags, we would definitely pick them up also because we understand that the leaves fell late this year. As far as our composting site, we are working with the school district, doing a collaboration, also talking with Susquehanna Township. And the site will be up there where the old middle school's at, where the old middle school used to be at. So again, Matt Miller, who isn't here right now, but he's working with DEP, and that's going well. That's going well. So that's more information will be coming with that.
Okay, but lots of exciting things happening there. Okay, Dave, sanitation. Let's talk sanitation. When are folks going to start to see some new equipment on the streets, and how has generally the transition been going?
I also want to thank you for this format, sir, inviting me to
informing residents of what's going on in sanitation. Sanitation there, we have a numerous amount of great things going on in sanitation today with our very own new toilet system, and that is going well. And speaking of the toilet system, we have just received a new shipment of toilets. We have a very long waiting list for the delivery of new toilets, you know, and we have started the distribution of the toters from the waiting list. So just have some patience with us. We will get to you. We have created our own toter distribution department that city never had before, as we never had a toter system before. We became aware that we needed a toter repairman, toter deliverer. So the toter department in itself has created another department. So we will get to you. We understand that you don't have any cans. The Public Works Director Aaron Johnson and myself has advised our sanitation department to pick up your refuge, regardless if you have the toter or not, because we are aware that we were behind in that aspect. And the toter system is a great system, you know. And John Rerkin has done a great job in enforcing this system. And we also have the recycling, which has quadrupled. We have went from, let's say, 6%, we're now up to 22% on the recycling, which decreases the refuse, but we want to recycle. We want to recycle. So that is also a great thing that's happening with the city. We have purchased new equipment packers for the sanitation department, which are on order. They're being made from the companies as we speak. They will be in sometime in the spring. And we also are revising the sanitation routes, which we have another employee who is following the sanitation packers in the routes to make sure that the new packers have access through the alleys, and if it's unsafe for the alleys because of the new packers versus the old alleys and the things that we used to do versus what we do now, we are making the determination whether we need to put trash out front. Is it safe to go in the alley? Do we need to remove trees? Do we need to pave a road in the where we go down the alley? There's so many things that we're doing at the present time. And up to this point, it's been great. We are on our second route. We'll be on our third route starting next Monday. So we will continue until we finish the process to revitalizing the sanitation routes.
That's great. So if people want toters, they can call in. They can call into 311, give their address. We'll add them to the list. We've got more toters on order. In general, that transition's gone well. Same thing with recycling containers. If they need a new recycling container, I'm sure they can request that from you.
Yes, sir.
New trucks coming in the spring.
Yes, sir.
And currently underway is a revision of potential routes. Now, before we change anything, we'll be sure to be back to the public and let them know with plenty of advance notice if anything's going to change. But the idea of maybe relocating some of the places where people put their trash and changing some of the routes is a good one from an efficiency standpoint.
Yes.
So people won't see the old street sweepers, but they will see some new trucks. And can you also give an update on how some of the commercial accounts have been transitioning and where we stand with that?
Yes, we are. We actually have transitioned a lot of commercial accounts. There were accounts that they were getting trash picked up and we didn't know about it. There were accounts that were paying too much. There were accounts that we didn't have any clue about. And we're also are in our second phase of our privatization takeover, which is going very well, you know. And actually, it's going even better than we thought it would. You know, we thought we would have resistance, and we would like to thank the businesses that are in the city of Harrisburg for cooperating with us with this transition, because it makes it go even more smoothly when everyone is working together, and that has been happening. So
in general, we appreciate everyone's cooperation. It's been a lot of change in a short period of time from a sanitation standpoint, with even more to come.
Yes.
Okay. Well, Wayne, let me turn to you, because I also know on people's minds what are some of the major projects on the horizon? What can people expect to see, you know, for 2017?
Yeah, thank you, Mayor, for inviting me here to speak today and inform the residents of some of these projects. I think one of the biggest projects we'll see here, hopefully starting spring, summer 2017, will be the Third Street Multimodal Project. We were awarded grants from both PennDOT Multimodal Grant and also a grant from Impact Harrisburg to fund that project. It's in design right now. I'm happy to say it's about 50% complete with design. Traffic signal permits are with PennDOT for review. Some environmental documentation has been submitted for review with the appropriate authorities, and we're working through that design right now. What residents can expect is a lot of pedestrian-related improvements, similar to what the state did at 3rd and North. We're going to use that as a model and put in some curb extensions and bulb outs at signalized intersections, improve the ADA accessibility by installing new ramps at the intersections and along the corridor, some traffic signal improvements instead of those somewhat annoying beep beeps and chirp chirps that some of the traffic signals give off. It'll actually let the visually impaired pedestrians, it'll actually speak to them and let them know that, you know, Chestnut Street, for example, is now safe to cross. New technology, but then also new asphalt, which will be welcome, especially on some sections of 3rd Street where UGI just finished upgrading theirs. And continuing on with some of the UGI stuff, the engineer office does monitor all the utility cuts in the city. UGI is under a federal mandate to replace some of those gas main lines, and we make sure that they restore the road to its proper condition. There's only a short period of time between April and October when hot asphalt is made by the plants. So, you know, for example, there's some areas in the city where UGI worked over the winter months and put in some temporary, patching and stuff. Rest assured, we'll be following up with them in the spring and in summer, making sure that the final restoration is made and the road will look better than it did before, you know, they came through. So,
good. You know, two specific, so 3rd Street's very exciting, mm-hmm. and I know that that's part of an overall plan to try and make Harrisburg more walkable and accessible for pedestrians and bikers and changing traffic patterns. Mm-hmm. A couple projects that I get asked about a lot, maybe you could give just brief updates on those. One is, where do we stand with working to redesign that intersection near Derry and Berry Hill, near mm-hmm. the schools there? Mm-hmm. I've been with you at meetings, with PennDOT on that, but let the public know what's happening. And then what is the status of this exciting grant that we got to repair the Riverwalk? I think people ask about both of those projects regularly.
Right, so the Derry Street, Berry Hill, 19th Street intersection is sort of an odd intersection right in front of two schools, five-leg signalized intersection. Anyone who's been through that area, especially when a school's letting out or kids are getting dropped off, realizes how complicated and challenging it is. We've done some preliminary sort of planning and laid out some roundabout scenarios and some other scenarios to basically eliminate the signalized intersection. And we presented that to PennDOT, who is doing another safety improvement along Derry Street, a federally funded project to make safety improvements along Derry Street. Because Derry Street is a PennDOT road and 19th Street south of Derry is a PennDOT owned road, they have jurisdictions over those. So they agreed to look at that as part of that safety study and provide us with feedback within the next 10 months, say, whether or not, you know, the roundabout scenario they would accept, and we can move forward either with PennDOT or on our own to make, you know, those improvements to the intersection. I will say, in the meantime, just this past weekend, in fact, our traffic signal maintenance crew was out there They installed 12-inch signal heads instead of the 8-inch, so they're bigger, and put yellow back plates, and then also pedestrian countdown displays to try and improve the safety in the interim. Because even when we get into the final design, you're still looking at a couple years until like a roundabout scenario or something like that would go to construction. It just things take time, and
the Riverwalk,
right? So we're really excited about the Riverwalk. When we came in, 2014, the Riverwalk was funded to patch following Tropical Storm Lee. The problem was Tropical Storm Lee happened years before, and a lot of those areas were a lot worse than the funding allowed. So the decision was made to just basically replace part of the Riverwalk slab that was in the worst condition, and that was the section near Shipoke. And the funding was used for that with the hope that we'd be able to fund the rest of the project through some other funding source. And we were aggressive in pursuing various funding sources, and we're pleased to announce that the PennDOT TAP grant, Transportation Alternative Program, we were awarded $1 million, which was the maximum amount available, and we're going to put that into that Riverwalk slab. So.
And what should people expect in terms of timing?
Realistically, although the design is relatively simple, it's a concrete sidewalk. It's not all that complicated. It does get dialed into the steps, and there are some permit issues, DEP general permits, and things like that can take some time. Realistically, we would love to start it this summer. Obviously, there's a lot of planned events. I know marathons, half marathons, runs, different events that are planned. So we're going to take a look at those once the design is complete and we're ready to bid it out, and just make sure that we provide enough advance notice to some of these event organizers and things. The construction, concrete can be poured in some pretty cold conditions. The problem could be ice flows of the river and stuff like that. So we'll have to carefully plan that construction phase.
Great. Okay. More to come there. That's very exciting. Okay, Aaron, back to you. Over the past couple of years, the Public Works Department has really come back. There have been an awful lot of hiring. Obviously, we focused originally on sanitation and needing to get that in order. But this year, we're planning to hire 6 new parks maintenance workers. And I thought maybe you could talk a little bit about what that means for the public and how that should be able to help us address our park system.
Okay, you're absolutely right, sir. 6 labor threes, that's unheard of for me, because I've been here over 20 years, all at one time. Again, I want to thank you for basically supporting our cause, and everything that we have done, all this new equipment that we're receiving. But to speak on those labors, far as Parks and Rec Maintenance Department, as you know, it's 27 parks and playgrounds. So that's a lot of area that you cover. And at one time, we only had 9 people to do all that. We talked about maybe 10 or 15 years ago, but about 15 years ago, you had about 22 people in that department. Again, our park system is beautiful, but that's a lot of area to cover. So what those 6 new bodies will do for us is to allow us our cutting cycle, when that rain comes in, that sun comes out, that grass grows rapidly. So that'll allow us to give us basically like 3 cutting crews. And again, that'll be allow us to actually try to stay ahead, because out of that cutting crew, our tree guys was involved. So that allows us more flexibility, and we're very excited about that. Matter of fact, I just did one interview today for one of those positions. So, and I got a couple more interviews next week, but very excited about it. Very excited about it and much needed. And again, I want to thank you very much for supporting our cause.
Well, hopefully we'll have these folks hired for the spring, and we will be able to not only address the cutting cycle, but keep our parks better maintained. At the same time, we also have this study underway at Reservoir Park for a complete reimagining of what that park might look like. We have money going into the band shell for repairs there. We have a series of playgrounds throughout the city that are getting completely refurbished. So an awful lot going on the park side. And Dave, I'll turn to you. Let's talk a little bit about why it's important to have a sort of new permanent home for our Public Works Department, and what that might mean in terms of being able to maintain equipment and the morale and everything else that goes into running a department. We don't have to get into the specifics of where, but I know that as many people read, we put some millions of dollars aside in this year's budget for the acquisition of a new home. What would that mean to you and to everyone?
Yes, sir. So, yeah, the importance, and again, as Aaron stated, that we really want to thank you for your support for our cause, because it's important that we have our own public works facility, because a public works facility has to have its own character of departments, which, you know, we house our equipment. We have sanitation packers that we need to house. We have heavy equipment because we have a highway department that we need to house our equipment. You know, we're at the facility that we're in, we're there, you know, we had to have somewhere to go, but we need our own public works facility, and it will continue to boost morale. We have a buy-in from the team of employees that we have in our departments, and they work hard. They work hard for us, they work well, and they are in support of what we're our cause also, you know, a revitalization of the sanitation department. They believe, we would like the residents to believe, this turnaround has to be in a whole, a cooperation with everyone, you know, so it can work. And the public works facility is so detriment for us to have in order for our purpose to be served and our equipment to last, because you have to take care of the equipment in order for the equipment to last. And if you don't have the housing, just the elements itself from nature can deteriorate your equipment.
So what the public can look for this year is the acquisition of a site, a permanent site for Public Works. And then in future years, the construction of a new facility could be the first major city-sponsored public facility constructed in Harrisburg, and who knows how long. So that can be part, I think, of a lot of the development that we're going to see in the next several years. It's exciting.
May I ask one more question?
Sure. So, yeah.
Please, if I may, as Aaron stated about the sweeping department, you know, because we no longer sweep the streets, and we don't need that department as far as a highway, it gives us an opportunity to focus even more on the potholes in the streets of the city of Harrisburg. We have created a team. As soon as the spring breaks, that we're able to have a crew to go out. We have a hot box now that we're able to carry hot asphalt. We're able to fill the potholes in the correct way, in which at one time the only thing that we were able to do was put coal patch. It was a temporary fix. We're now able to fix and complete the potholes the way that they're supposed to be. So that crew, that sweeping crew, along with the small paving department that we already have, the city's in the process of purchasing a small paver, so the streets that we, small alleys that we need to do the paving on, that we will be able to do that. So look forward to us paving the potholes and fixing the streets a lot more than we have been, because the manpower has increased because of that.
That's right. And I think the public needs to know that that's part about building capacity in public works.
Yes.
Having enough people to do sanitation means not having to pull people off potholes and demolition to do sanitation. Having
yes.
enough people in parks
yes.
maintenance means not having to pull people off to do that. So
yes,
now we have dedicated folks that are going to be able to work on not only paving and potholes, but basically on their primary focus, including things like demolition. So that's the ripple effect of all these hirings
yes.
that we're having.
Yes.
Great. And and Wayne, looking ahead beyond this year, can you give us an update on some exciting things in the future?
So a few PennDOT projects are in design phase. One is major renovations to the McClay Street Bridge over the rail yard between 7th Street and Cameron. That will have a major impact on the region, on traffic flows and things like that. Time frame 2020, 2021, probably construction start. The city is looking at a Second Street two-way. That preliminary engineering has begun. There's a lot of traffic mitigation projects that have to get underway before we just convert those traffic flows. Obviously, those traffic signals are only set up for one way, so it is a major project. But we're trying to make sure that it ties in with the McClay Street Bridge project, and also, as everybody I'm sure is aware, of the 83 widening project, which is going to change traffic patterns and traffic flows in the city.
And could lead to a whole nother means of exiting and entering the city of Harrisburg, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's within the next 10 decade, I would say, but a major potential issue. And I know there's so much to talk about, and we've covered a lot of ground, but can you give just a very short update on the sinkhole in South 14th Street and where we stand there so residents know?
Right, so we're finalizing the funding documents, which is basically grant agreements. Those have to be I's dotted, T's crossed, executed by the appropriate officials. The state is hiring a relocation specialist to work with the tenants who will be displaced, unfortunately, as a result of the buyout of these sinkhole affected properties. And we're working to get our consultants in place, the attorneys who are going to do the closings, of the purchase of those properties, and the geotechnical consultants that are going to design, prepare the demolition plans and make sure that we're not impacting the rest of the neighborhood during demolition and things of that nature. So it's moving fast, it's moving furious. There's a couple of town hall meetings, but more like neighborhood meetings with the residents, the affected residents and property owners coming up, next week. So it's moving ahead.
Yep. And the city just passed or is about to pass a tax, property tax relief package for those residents, and it's all moving. That acquisition and the settlement on all those homes should happen this year. So that's something else to look forward to. Aaron, I'm going to give you the last word. Is there anything else you want to convey regarding your department to the public?
Yes, sir. Let's talk about leaf collection. The city of Harrisburg will still maintain the streets as far as street leaf collection, which based on the weather, sometime like spring came early. So as soon as those leaves start start falling, you do yard work. So we want to say like April, we do leaf collection from April to December. The good news is that we are purchasing four new leaf collection machines, single man operation, and that would allow us to free up some more manpower to do other things, like Dave was mentioning about a paving crew. So we're very excited about that because we have old equipment. So we should receive them, that's from a 902 grant from DEP. And we should be receiving some of that equipment, I would say probably July, around about that time frame. Like I said, very excited about it. Two uptown and be two on the hill. And it makes us be able to do our job more effectively. Mm-hmm. You got better equipment, but the key is we got to maintain that equipment, got to take care of it, for us to be able to last us. So again, sir, I want to thank you for allowing us to the resident you hear from, from the public work side. And I want the public to understand and want them to know that we're here to serve you. I mean, we're pretty visible around the city, And again, Dave can give his number out. And a lot of people wonder why I give my number out. Because, again, you can call the office or you can call the 311. We prefer you to call 311 so it can go through the system. But if you really need to talk to me and you're not getting no satisfaction, then I don't have a problem with you calling me direct. But we are here to serve you. We've been here over 20 years. And, again, we are really moving in the right direction. Very excited about what's going on.
Okay, well, thanks very much for that. I want to thank all three of you. The public has so much to look forward to. New packers and trash trucks in the spring, new leaf collection vehicles in the fall, new paving projects now and in the future, a greater capacity, people doing work all over the city in every part of Harrisburg. And we thank you all for your leadership. Thank you for watching at home and joining us for another edition of Word in the Burg. We'll be back next time with more issues that matter to you, relevant to the city of Harrisburg and the region. Thank you for watching.